Welcome to Human Anatomy and Physiology Lab number 7. In this week's lab, we'll be finishing up the last section on the gross anatomy of the musculoskeletal system, the lower limbs, as well as introducing concepts in skeletal muscle physiology using electromyography. As just mentioned, we'll be completing last section of exercise 13 in the lab book, looking at the muscles of the lower extremity. The objectives of this section are to be able to identify specific muscles of the lower limb, including their origin insertions, using the lab manual and visible body software found in the lab. The observed actions and resulting body motions can be visualized using the visible body software, as well as the skeletal models found in the lab. Workbook assignment number 1 is currently posted on Blackboard and corresponds to this portion of the lab. There are also 2 reading assignments posted on Blackboard regarding the second portion of this lab covering electromyography. Please read these and be familiar with them prior to coming to the lab. We'll be using the Power Lab equipment introduced last week to examine the EMG response during voluntary muscle contractions, as well as evoked responses during electrical stimulation. The pre-lab content for this component lab will be covered in a separate video, just like last week's intro to Power Lab. Along with the EMG reading assignments posted on Blackboard is a workbook assignment for this portion of the lab. We started off exercise 13, looking at the muscles of the head, neck, and trunk. And last week, we covered the muscles of the upper limb. This week, we'll be focusing on the lower extremity, specifically the muscles crossing the hip, knee, and ankle joints. In general, just like the muscles of the upper extremities, muscles located on the anterior surface are primarily responsible for flexion, whereas muscles located on the posterior surfaces are responsible primarily for extension. The one obvious exception are the muscles that span the knee joint. In this case, the knee flexors are associated with the posterior aspect of the knee, whereas the knee extensors are located on the anterior aspect. This is due to the fact that knee flexion occurs in the posterior direction as opposed to the anterior direction like most of the other joints of the body. Starting with the muscles on the anterior portion crossing the hip joint, the hip flexors, most superiorly, we have the iliopsoas muscle. This muscle is actually 2 distinct muscles sharing a common insertion site on the femur. The iliacus, seen here, originates on the anterior aspect of the ilium and as such only crosses the hip joint, facilitating hip flexion only. Whereas the psoas major, the other component of the iliopsoas, is much longer and continues upward into the lumbar region of the lower spine. Because of this, not only does it facilitate flexion at the hip, but it also produces flexion of the lumbar region as well. More distally, we have the sartorius muscle, which is a long biarticulate muscle, meaning that it crosses 2 joints. Since it crosses 2 joints, it is able to produce motion at both of these joints. In the case of the hip, since it runs anterior to the hip joint center, it can be used as a hip flexor. From its origin, it runs medially and inserts on the proximal end of the tibia, allowing for knee flexion as well. Due to the orientation of this muscle, running from lateral to medial, it can also produce or facilitate hip abduction as well as external rotation. The pectineus and gracilis are uniarticulate muscles, seen here, meaning they only cross a single joint, in this case, the hip joint, and are located more medial relative to the femur, and as such, are responsible for flexion, adduction, as well as internal rotation. Also located in the anterior compartment are the quadricep muscles, consisting of the rectus femoris, the vastus lateralis, the vastus medialis, and just deep to these 3 is the vastus intermedius muscle. The rectus femoris can be seen most superficially here, with the vasti muscles lying directly beneath it. Of the 4 quadricep muscles, only 1 crosses the hip joint, the rectus femoris, so the most superficial. Since it's anterior to both the hip and knee joint, it is able to produce flexion at the hip, as well as extension at the knee. The three vasti muscles, on the other hand, only cross the knee and therefore can only contribute to knee extension. Here we can see more clearly the deep muscles of the anterior compartment, of the thigh, specifically the uniarticulate muscles of the vasti group. So we have the lateralis here, the medialis here, and in between them is the intermedius. Whereas the rectus femoris actually crosses the hip joint and has its origin up on the anterior superior or anterior inferior iliac spine. In the medial compartment of the thigh are the primary hip adductors. These are used to return the leg to the midline of the body or to the anatomical position after the hip has been abducted. They consist of the adductor brevis, the adductor longus, and the adductor magnus. Depending on their specific origin on the ischium and pubis and the hip joint angle at any given point in time, they can also be used for hip flexion and or extension as well. Moving around to the posterior aspect of the thigh, we have the primary hip extensors and knee flexors. Most superficially, we have the gluteus maximus, the most powerful hip extensor. This muscle can also be used for abduction as well as external rotation of the hip. The gluteus medius and minimus is smaller in size and more laterally located. As such, their contribution to hip extension is limited, but they can be used for hip abduction and internal rotation as well. Next are what is commonly referred to as the hamstring muscles, the biceps femoris group, which is located most laterally, and the semitendinosus and semimembranosus located more medially. The biceps femoris muscles are comprised of two heads, the long head and the short head. As the long head indicates, it is longer than the short head. And the biggest distinction between these two muscles is the short head of the bicep is the only hamstring muscle that only spans one joint. So it only crosses the knee joint and so can only contribute to knee flexion. The other three muscles, semitendinosus, semimembranosus, and the long head of the bicep, span the hip joint as well. So in addition to facilitating flexion at the knee, they can all three produce hip extension as well. Moving on to the lower leg, in the anterior compartment, we have the tibialis anterior, primarily responsible for dorsiflexion of the ankle, and we can see that it wraps around the medial aspect of the foot distally. This allows it to contribute to inversion of the foot as well. Just lateral to this muscle, we have the extensor digitorum longus, and as the name implies, it serves to extend the digits or the toes of the foot. Between and deep to these two muscles is the extensor hallucis longus. This muscle is used to extend the big toe. And finally, we have the fibularis tertius, also known as the pronius tertius. This muscle is used in dorsiflexion and due to its lateral insertion is also used in eversion of the foot. The lateral compartment of the leg consists of the fibularis longus, seen here, and the fibularis brevis, or the pronius longus and brevis. Both these muscles pass posterior to the lateral malleolus of the ankle, seen here, allowing them to contribute to plantar flexion of the foot, and sensor insertion is on the lateral aspect of the foot, specifically the metatarsals. They're also used in eversion of the foot as well. Moving around to the posterior compartment of the leg, we have the primary plantar flexors of the foot and the remaining knee flexors. Most superficially, we have the gastrocnemius muscles that span both the knee joint as well as the ankle joint. At the knee joint, they produce knee flexion and at the ankle joint, they are responsible for plantar flexion. Just deep to this muscle is the soleus, which we can see here. This muscle only crosses the ankle joint and is primarily responsible for plantar flexion. We can see the arrangement of the soleus relative to the gastrocs more clearly here. So essentially we have removed the more superficial gastroc muscles, revealing the main body of the soleus. And so we can see it's a relatively large muscle, and it goes from the most proximal end of the tibia and fibula almost all the way down to the calcaneus. So due to the overall length of this muscle relative to the relatively short gastroc muscles, this muscle is able to produce force over a greater range of motion than what we would expect to see from the gastroc muscle. Finally, in the posterior deep compartment of the leg are the muscles primarily responsible for plantar flexion and foot inversion. We can see that these muscles run medial and posterior to the medial malleolus. The tibialis posterior is a primary foot inverter originating on both the tibia and fibula. This muscle can also be used in plantar flexion. The flexor digitorum longus, originating on the posterior aspect of the tibia, is used primarily for toe flexion, but can also contribute to plantar flexion and inversion of the foot as well. And finally, we have the flexor hallucis longus. This muscle is used for primarily flexion of the big toe, but can also be used for plantar flexion and inversion of the foot as well. This concludes muscles of the lower extremities, the final section of gross anatomy of the musculoskeletal system. Please also review the video pertaining to the EMG portion of the lab prior to coming to lab this week.